Hello, my name is Morgan Gray, and welcome back to the Afrocentric Podcast.
With anybody who don't love a beautiful black queen, baby. You see this tape.
When they go low, I go low. Oh.
You don't let nobody act black and then go home and be white.
I got two pistols and a pit bull. Me. That's all I need.
It only takes a little bit of white brainwash to activate the coon chip in the average Negro.
You think Harriet Tubman was walking around with a fucking nice shiny fucking dress on with a fucking crown on her head when she was taking slaves to freedom?
And a lot of white folk have demonstrated eloquently that they don't have no sense.
And we are back with the Afrocentric Podcast. Happy Black History Month to all my niggas in the back. I see you niggas still holding it strong and savvy for the home front. God is blessing all the real niggas and the trap dealers and the scammers and such. And I'm just so happy to be here with you all. The title of this episode is Part 3, The Subtle Art of Dismantling White Supremacy. And before I introduce my speaker, I just want to say that I'm so excited to be here with you guys, as well as getting the opportunity to talk to you guys about white supremacy culture, and the dismantlement thereof. Now, I'm happy to have the most intelligent, soft-spoken, but brilliant Leah in the building. Go ahead and introduce yourself, Leah.
Hi, y'all. I'm Leah. I've been at Mississippi State University for a while, obtaining my education. I'm a big field of advocates. I teach here now, and so I have a unique experience with white supremacy in the educational space. I'm excited to just talk to y'all today about that.
Very well said, and I know that we are so excited to hear your thoughts on it. This episode specifically, me and Leah will be discussing the final five characteristics of white supremacy. Those characteristics include individualism, the I am the only one mindset, the belief that progress is always bigger, better, and more, objectivity, as well as the right to comfort. Now, in this episode, Leah and I will be discussing the different scholarly works focusing on white supremacy culture, capitalism, as well as how white supremacy plays out in the educational space. Now, before we divulge into this conversation, Sugar, is there anything that you would like to say, get up off your chest before we dive in?
I think the thing that irritates me the most about white supremacy is the ignorance of white supremacy and the people not acknowledging white privilege.
Very well said. Let's go ahead and hop into the rest of this episode.
Let's get ready to rumble!
Damn.
Y'all killing me with this.
Here at the Afrocentric podcast, we play a lovely icebreaker, and it is entitled Fight, Marry, Kill, African American Edition. Now, for those who do not know and are new to the podcast, Fight, Marry, Kill, African American Edition puts a classic twist on the classic Fuck, Marry, Kill concept. And Leah, I'll be introducing you the names of three household African American celebrities, and you're going to have to tell me whether you're going to fight, whether you're going to marry them, or if you're going to put them in a 6x4 box. You feel okay. me? All right, so Leah, Fight, Marry, Kill, Deion Sanders, Shannon Sharp, and Nicki Minaj. Oh. I don't know.
Oh, he's trying to get you canceled.
What's funny is, y'all, me and Leah was just debating. We were just debating before this episode even started about Nicki Minaj and Meg. So I just can't wait to hear your answer.
Okay, right over the top, I'm gonna marry Deion.
You gonna marry him?
I'm gonna marry Deion.
He a coon, Leah. You can't be giving your womb to Deion. The coon.
See, look at Deion's kids. They all look good. He make good little kids. And he look at his women. They look good. He got good.
You focus on the wrong thing. You need to be looking at his wallet. His wallet look good too now.
They look real good. They'll look real good.
Yeah, he getting that sellout. He getting that sellout money.
Hey. I ain't gonna fight Shannon. He big. I'm gonna fight Nicki.
You think you can hold up against Nicki? Leah, you little now. Mm-hmm. Her ass and her thigh is bigger than you.
I'm gonna just kick her.
Why you wanna kick Nicki Minaj, Leah?
Cause she just talks to me. She talks to me. She didn't have to be quiet. You sat at the draw of the queen around. Like, just sat there and let the youngest fight. You shouldn't be in there no more.
My God, that was powerful.
Yeah, and I'm had to kill Shannon.
What's your weapon of choice?
I'm had to shoot him because he just said that, you know, he just had said that Beyonce is number two. So I'm had to go ahead and kill him.
He is also a coon.
He just talked too much too. Like,
you know, he on Dr. Umar's lash list.
Yeah, not the Umar gonna have to help me with them because Shannon a little.
I think probably all three of them might get a couple lashes from Dr. Umar. Okay, so your final decision, you are going to fight Shannon Sharp. You are marrying Deion Sanders, the white man in black skin. And you are going to, hold on, you going to kill Shannon Sharp.
Yeah.
You is marrying Deion Sanders, and you going to fight Nicki Minaj.
Yeah.
Wow, that is a true testament to how much of a powerful woman you are. I really love that for you, young lady. Thank you so much for playing Fight, Marry, Kill, African American Edition, everybody's favorite game.
And what do you say about white supremacy today?
Part of what I say is that white supremacy, first of all, isn't a white thing. It's part of this culture. It's part of how all of us have been taught to think about difference. Who's better? Who's inferior? Who's superior? I prefer white supremacy to racism precisely because it says that we're all being socialized to think along certain dualistic lines, and that the notion of that which is light or white being better, that which is dark or black being worse, bad, inferior, is something that everyone in the culture is socialized to think.
So far in this series, we have gone over 10 characteristics of white supremacy culture. Those characteristics are perfectionism, the sense of urgency, defensiveness, quantity over quality, the worship of the written word, only one right way, paternalism, either or thinking, hand or power hoarding, and the fear to open conflict. Now, in this episode, we will be going over the 5 final characteristics of white supremacy culture. And those characteristics are individualism, I am the only one mindset, the idea that progress is bigger and more, objectivity, as well as the right to comfort. So my first question to you, Leah, as a whole, what is white supremacy?
So white supremacy to me is the belief that there's a sense of superiority when it comes to the white race, compared to non-white individuals in other communities. It also transcends into things like racism, discrimination, politics, and policies that reflect that sense of superiority on others.
Okay, so what is your relationship with white supremacy and how has it impacted you personally?
Where do my eyes? Everything is dark.
Open your eyes and you might be able to see something, fool.
To be quite frank, I've never dealt with white supremacy until I was 18. So I guess I was one of those people that were oblivious to the world. I thought it had changed because I lived in an all-black town. I went to all-black school, so I'd never dealt with white individuals inserting a sense of supremacy or superiority to me. But when I started school in the Trump administration era, during college, a political science major, white supremacy was everywhere. It was in the classroom.
It was in the air.
It was everywhere. It was in the cafeteria. It was in the restaurant. It was everywhere. It was in Walmart. It was everywhere because everybody felt that a small town person like me, a small girl with a small voice, didn't have the right to be in these rooms that I was in. So I finally felt like, okay, these people think they're better than me, not because they have more knowledge than me, not because they have more experience than me, but simply because they have a lighter skin than me. They don't have melanin. They have straighter hair than me. My hair is coarse. That's what it was about. So that was really my relationship, and still is my relationship with white supremacy. It's still here. It's still existing. And for the time being, I don't think it's going anywhere because nobody even acknowledged it, really.
And I completely agree with you on the fact that you think it's not going anywhere. Can you, like, divulge more information on that thought?
I say that because look around.
What if I'm blind, Leo?
Even every one step forward for the black population, the black community, is 600 steps forward for the white community and white individuals.
Why is that?
Because it's a thing. You can't start a race when you already you can't start a race when you already an equal race when you already are 300 years behind. So we have slavery, we have Jim Crow laws, we have segregation, we have police brutality, we have all these aspects that are still fighting. They were fighting against us the whole time while white people had nothing but opportunity to advance and move ahead. So there's no way that you can play catch up. It's never going to be a point that I feel, maybe I'm a pessimist, that we're on the same level in their mindsets or in the views of the world, that we're on the same level as white people.
I think that is extremely true, but statistics are telling us
it's only the fourth day of Black History Month, y'all, and I'm already pissed. Let's talk about this article. This is from Bloomberg, y'all. It will take Black Americans 320 years to catch up to white neighbors. It will take more than three centuries for Black Americans to achieve the same quality of life as their white neighbors after the racial gap widened in more than half the country in the past decade. The 320 years is in rural counties like in Caddo Parish, Louisiana, and in more urban areas like New York and San Francisco, it's around 160 years. Only 48% of U.S. counties reduced the racial gap in the past decade. No U.S. county with a significant Black population has achieved parity, and the 37 that are close to it house just 0.1% of the total U.S. Black population. The study assumes that results for white residents will remain at today's levels, but notes that those estimates are conservative because their conditions are likely to improve over time. So we're seeing the quality of life decreasing for Black people in this country, and the quality of life improving for white people in this country, noted. They analyzed 25 metrics related to the quality of life, including rates of poverty and food insecurity, job opportunities, life expectancy, and the incarceration rate across the U.S. from megacities to rural areas. And the report highlights that a number of solutions can be used to help bridge the gap, including affordable housing in mixed income areas, health insurance for U.S. residents without coverage, and the expansion of high-quality early education programs. I'm upset for so many reasons. Obviously, the first is the fact that gap even exists, period. But also, like, during our month of Black History Month, how could you come so close but be so far? In this article, obviously the article is reporting on what's actually in that results from McKinsey, and I'm gonna go and actually read that to try to see what they say. But the fact that slavery, Jim Crow, discrimination, like, how is that not mentioned in the article as the cause for this gap? Like, how can you talk about a symptom but not talk about the cause of the symptom? And it's just so crazy to me because, like, okay, we've made some progress in the sense that, like, for many years they would have never made an article like this. But now you know what the issue is, and you're not actually doing anything to solve the problem. And to me, that's worse than saying we're just going to ignore it, period, because you know what's going on. But now what's the next step? Like, let's stop talking about it and let's start actually doing them actions and not just acknowledging the fact that we know that these things will improve people's lives, but actually doing the things to improve people's lives. This is exactly why I started my page and I make videos like this, because I'm ready to hold corporate America, the finance industry, and the business industry accountable, okay? Y'all say that you want diversity. You say that you want to see improvements. Okay, so let's do the work. And the issue is that a lot of times they're not willing to go as far as they need to go. They just want to do a little bit and not do the whole thing. So I'm here saying it's time to step up. And in every place that I'm in, I will be holding people accountable to actually do the steps that will lead to actual change and improvement.
Specifically, when it comes to Black women, that Black women are starting to catch up. We have the highest education rate, graduation rate, fastest amount of entrepreneurs growing in America. Our jail rates are going up. But I feel like in a lot of different instances and cases, we are starting to catch up. And I guess my question to you is why do you think that Black women specifically are starting to catch up?
Because we're resilient. We don't let things stop us. We don't let the naysayers and the noise, we don't let that drown us out. We don't let how we're painted on through the media, how we're painted in society, and how we've been painted through social media and television shows and all of this, are reality TV shows where we're throwing drinks at each other. That's not the reality that we live in. So we don't let that outside noise get in. I personally sit in a room with Black women all the time that are very educated, highly, you know, influential. So I do think that Black women are making a progress, but we are still the minority.
You know, the Hispanic population has officially risen to majority status. Officially, so we're a double minority now,
but and that's also due to things like, you know, gentrification and sterilization,
redlining,
and environmental racism, putting Black
medical racism
in houses that were filled with lead paint, or environments that had gas all in the air, so kids getting sick, women inhaling this gas is impacting your fertility rates and all of this. So I think that plays a lot in there. Like I said, that's why I feel how I feel about white supremacy. Like, even this progress we're making, we're not repopulating as fast as other races are.
Yeah, and so, I think that is the cost that we have to pay in order for us to get what we want. And we are, so many of us, breaking those generational curses. I do want to add on to what you said when we were talking about why it seems like Black women are succeeding so much. I think that white supremacy definitely stifled the progress of white people because they didn't have the work for what they wanted to obtain. A lot of stuff was passed down to them or handed to them because they were white. A great statistic of that, it shows that white felons are like 4 times more likely to get hired over just an educated Black man, just because people will give them an opportunity because they see the color of their skin and look over with their criminal history. Yes. But I'm saying this to say that, like, we have generations of women who worked so hard and they've obtained everything they've gotten just off of the sweat of their brow because they've earned it. And then you have generations of white people who have not done the work. So it's making them intergenerationally a little slower. Their work ethic is not as well. And they seem a little, what is the word I'm looking for? Like, they're supposed to get what they pride for. So I think that is why we're doing so well, because we have intergenerationally worked ourselves out of that position. We haven't worked ourselves out of it, but we're lifting as we're climbing.
He says a majority of our sample tends to think that we made steady progress towards greater equality and wealth between family. We've made steady progress? Excuse me. One of the white universities just put out a report on the wealth gap and income gap between Black family and white family. We just had a report put out on the wealth and income gap between the Black and the whites. And according to your universities, it would take 225 years and a whole lot of government intervention for black wealth to equal white wealth. What the hell you white people talking about? And this is why we got to be careful treating black millionaires as black progress. Because America is creating all these black millionaires to hide the black poverty, to hide the black disenfranchisement, to hide the lack of availability of wealth in the black community. They're using our celebrities to distract away from the real economic conditions of black America. They're using millionaires and billionaires to distract away from the poverty, the homelessness, and the unemployment. Millionaires are tokens. Billionaires are tokens. Don't let a token speak for you. Celebrities are tokens. Don't let a token speak for you.
How do the characteristics of white supremacy, like individualism and the I'm the only one mindset, intersect with broader societal structures and perpetuate systemic inequality?
The idea of individualism, that you're the only one, is everywhere. It's infiltrated itself into black culture. So individualism is the idea that you feel like everything is about you. You're making it self-centered. You're not thinking about other people. It's only about your experience, your self-experience. So that in its own, like, for instance, my favorite example of an individual was Steve Jobs. Steve Jobs, in the way of individualism, he single-handedly felt like he was the only one that was doing it, but he didn't think about Microsoft. He didn't think about Samsung. He only thought about Apple. Mm-hmm. So these are companies that do similar things, but in his mind, he had the individualism thing. And individualism can be, I'm the only one mindset can hurt you or it can help you. And I think in the black culture, it does more. The white supremacy aspect, I feel like it helps them, but when it transcends into black culture, it hurts us.
Why do you think it hurts?
Because when you're saying the individual company, now you're thinking, okay, I'm the only one in this role, so I don't have anybody. If you do the research, you can find so many people who's taking this path that you've taken. Like, for so long, like when I was in political science classes, it wasn't a lot of people that looked like me. So I was still feeling like I'm the only one. But when I started to actually get out and talk to people, I found plenty of other people in here that were Mississippi State students who were political science major or knew somebody that was and had graduated and was in law school doing what I wanted to do. So I think when we get out of that mindset that I'm the only one going through this and we come together as a community, that can help us so much.
That's exactly what I wanted you to say. Community, you hit it right on the head. So I definitely am a believer that individualism is a byproduct of capitalism. And it is one of the biggest problems within the black community, because historically the black community has been just that, a community. So like, you see that when we're talking to like older people, when they talk about how they grew up together, or when one of them little boys was showing their ass, they would get whoopings from everybody within the community. They walk down the street, the bread man will whoop his ass. Then they go down the street, his uncle will snatch him up. Then his daddy gonna beat that ass black when he get home, because the community cared. They would make sure they would keep each other, feed one another. And now we're getting to this point where everything is individualistic. So like, if I'm struggling, that's my personal problem. That's not a we thing, that's a you thing. And honestly, when I think about individualism, I think about other countries that people would consider like third world countries, right? So like in Africa, there are small villages where the women would have the children, but it wouldn't be just the woman's responsibility to take care and maintenance and teach and grow the child, because it takes a village. So if a woman was out in the middle of like a square within the village, she could hand her baby off to another woman and she would take care of that baby. They would breastfeed the children collectively. The baby would be on everybody's teeth. But if you were in New York and you left your baby with a stranger on the sidewalk, people would look at you completely crazy because of an individualistic mindset. So I feel like what you said was correct. I feel like it is a detriment to the black community, because it keeps us from coming together as one.
It also established a sense of, I have to be better than the next person, even though they look like me, they sound like me, they talk like me. it's about me. It's, what is that? I got to get me that people be saying. I got to get me, which means by any means, I'm going to win. Whether that means pushing down my brother to get to the French line, then I'm going to do that. Instead of lifting each other up and pulling along. Do you know how many times in the white supremacy culture, in the white culture, that they cousin not half as qualified, but they going to put in the word with the boss to say, hey, my cousin looking for a job as well. But the individual aspect that they perpetuating into our culture and to make us believe, like, hey, it's every man for themselves. Mm. It's everybody for themselves.
You know what? And we see that in Greek culture, like in the Divine Nine. Like, anybody that is Greek, they'll tell you, once I joined this organization, they put me on, they put me in these places. And it's simply because they were Greek. But those opportunities are not afforded to the GDIs, the goddamn individuals. And I feel like if you're not a part of the community, then you just kind of lift out. And
you don't fit the standard of what the ideal person that they want to, you know, help out. You feel like they feel like you, you know, you perpetuate white traits. You're sing it out.
Yeah.
You're on your own because, hot topic. When black people go to PWIs, we're sitting it out from our community because we chose a predominantly white institution over historically black college and university. But we're all at the end goal. We're all trying to get
a degree,
their master's, their doctorate, which that's, but deep, like, you know, it's just that sense of culture that we're missing. And I think that that's a big thing to dismantling white supremacy, us coming together as a culture. Because at the end of the day, with how much white people, you know, bicker and do this, they're going to come together at the end.
Mm-hmm.
So we need to dismantle the idea of I'm the only one, or this is the individual trait, because we're all working towards the same goal, and that's to be better than we were the day before. So I think that is my take on, like, why I don't agree with individualism. Like, I am an individual. Yes, I am going to put myself first, but I'm also going to help my sisters and my brothers and my cousins and my uncles and my aunties, if I can,
mm-hmm.
to come along. Like,
and
if you want to win,
nigga down the street.
If you want to win, then let's win. But if you don't want to, then that's fine too. But if you want to win, let's get the win together.
I also wanted to talk about how individualism can really lead to isolation, because, like, right now we're definitely seeing, like, loneliness, like, on a high-ass record, and it's kind of crazy to think about it because we have all this access to technology, so we're always instantly connected to all these different people, but there is a sense of loneliness that's lingering, so I just kind of wanted to think, like, ask you what your thoughts were on that.
I think loneliness stems from speaking, especially in, like, for women of color, and I think even men of color, that a sense of loneliness stems from the idea that you don't want anybody. Like, when you get into that period of loneliness, when you're not feeling your best. Like, you know, when we win, we want everybody to know we win.
Mm-hmm.
We want everybody to know, I just got a new job, I just got a new house, you know. But when you 10 days behind on your rent, you don't want nobody to know that. When the bills are due, when your car is going to get repo, you don't want nobody to notice. I think we perpetuate loneliness when we're losing, when we are not at our best, which is when we need to lean into our community. We need to isolate that fear of loneliness. And I do feel like since the pandemic and since that period of isolation, forced isolation, it forced a lot of people to, like, sit back and think, and they realized they weren't who they thought they were. And I think that's also a key thing into why loneliness is so prevalent. And I think also loneliness stems from not knowing who you are as an individual. Because when you get to a point of comfort, you don't care. You don't need anybody around you to not be alone. You might be alone, but you're going to be lonely.
Mm-hmm.
When you find this is a comfort in who you are and being your own best friend.
Well, you keep yourself entertained. No, because let me tell y'all something. So Leah be on TikTok, like she said earlier. And Leah is similar to me where she lives alone. And, like, I love seeing your social media because, bitch, you be in there, bitch, by yourself having the most fun.
Yes, and I wasn't always like that. I grew up in a house with 5 siblings.
Yeah.
I grew up in a house where I was used to being around people. Then I came to college and I had a roommate. So I wasn't always that I knew how to be out of their loneliness. But when I sit down and realize I'm my own friend, I'm my biggest supporter, so why not have a time by myself? I'm going to take myself out to eat. I'm going to take myself out to stay. I'm going to travel by myself. I'm going to do everything. So, because guess what? When at the end of the day, when you lay down in bed, if you don't have a significant other, you land there by yourself. At the end of the day, your accountability. When you go, if you go do something against the law, it ain't gonna be nobody else you know, gets arrested.
When you die, you're going to go alone.
By yourself, completely alone. Nobody in the grave with you, no matter how much. So I think that it's not okay to like feel that loneliness, but let it marinate for a little while and see what's the source of their loneliness is. And if it's you not being comfortable with who you are, work on that. It's so much that we can fix by just working on something and identifying the problem.
Yeah.
I'm a big theorist. Like, identify the problem and come up with a solution for it.
Yes. Now, so, yes.
That's it. Some problems you can't fix, but try your earnest best to find a solution to the problem. It's a solution out there somewhere. You got too many resources, like you said. We can instantly connect with people. Stop being scared to post that TikTok. Stop being scared to...
Stop giving a fuck about what them folks think.
People don't think, stop giving care. Like, just stop caring.
And that's how you find community.
Literally, I've gained like 600 followers in the last couple of weeks on TikTok. And they come in and support me like they know me. I've never met any of these people there in my life.
Mm-hmm.
And that's good to have.
So when we are thinking about individualism, I just want to focus that there is little experience or comfort when it comes to working as a part of a team. People within organizations often believe that they are responsible for solving problems alone and not as a team. There's also an issue with accountability. So if any goes up and down, not sideways to peers or to those organizations it's set up to serve. And there is a desire for individual recognition and credit. And I think that is what's really, really bad. Like, people, they want credit for every little thing.
Yeah, everybody want credit, but you gotta give.
You get credit what credit do,
but you gotta earn your due.
Yes,
my parents just tell us you ain't getting no allowance unless you do them chores, and you might have helped your sister do her chores, but if your chores ain't completed, then guess what? You ain't earned your due.
And I think that goes back to like a sense of morality too.
You're like, I'm okay with taking a back seat. Like, if I did, this is my thing, if I did 5 minutes of work on a project that took 6 hours, my due is not to have my name plastered in the front page. My due is to say, oh yeah, she helped me for 5 minutes, and that was my due. Mm-hmm. I don't deserve the credit for whatever their product gonna reap versus that person who spent the other 5 hours and 55 minutes working on their project.
Yeah, help just to help.
And they stop looking for rewards out of helping people. Like, stop going to stuff with the intent, oh, I did this for you, so now I want some credit, or I did this for you, so give me some attention. So I think that's like, stop expecting people to, and stop expecting yourself from other people. Everybody don't have the same, like you said, morality. Everybody don't have the same morals as you.
I think that also goes for children too, because children are also getting to the point where they don't want to do nothing unless they receive a reward for it or an incentive for it, instead of just simply doing stuff out of the kindness of their own heart.
Because you've been told.
You've been taught that for every positive action, there is going to be a reward for it.
And that's not even true. Back to the biblical days, that's like, it's not true. Every positive thing not gonna be rewarded. What is gonna be rewarded is what's the end goal. Like, every time you submit an assignment, that's not, you don't feel like it's a reward, but when you get that degree, what you feel?
Yeah, you feel accomplished.
Like, you feel accomplished. So you work in incrementalism, piece by piece. You gonna build something. A house ain't put up in a day, but it can be tore down in a split second.
Come on, now. I just want to say that these characteristics, when we're talking about individualism, is often embedded in organizational culture. So like in workspaces or within schools, which we're primarily talked about, and they're used as what is considered to be normal or standards without being proactively chosen by the full group. And what this does is it leads to like the privilege of whiteness and the discrimination against non-white individuals in the workplace and in society at large. So let's go over some antidotes to combat against individualism, okay? So some of these antidotes include teamwork as an important value in your value statements, and make sure that the organization is working towards a shared goal and people understand how working together will really improve performance, as well as evaluating people's ability to work in a team as their abilities to get the job done. Secondly, let's make sure that the credit is given to all of those who participate in an effort and not just the leaders or the most public person, and make people accountable as a group rather than as individuals, and create a culture where people are being brought the problems to the group and not to individuals, right? So lastly, we're going to focus on using staff meetings as a place to solve problems and not just a place to report activities.
Look here, bruh. You read my mind.
This is how they get us. They'll promote a few blacks. Everybody else struggling. Everybody mm-hmm. else in poverty. Everybody else coming out of prison. But they'll promote a few blacks. And because a few blacks made it, that automatically supposed to mean that we are doing better. No other group you could push that on. Because every other group is based on collective group progress.
Right.
Black people, we are totally rooted in selfishness and me-ism. In order for racism to succeed, some blacks must be successful. Why do you need successful black people if you want to destroy our black people? Because in order to brainwash the other ones into believing that your failure is not due to systemic discrimination, it's due to the fact that you're not intelligent enough or you're not working hard enough. Mm. Do you see that? The black millionaire and billionaire class is one of white supremacy's greatest arguments to defend itself against accusations of racism. Because Oprah Winfrey is not going to indict the system. Mm-hmm. LeBron James is not going to indict the system. You understand me? Mm-hmm. Tyler Perry is not going to indict the system because they made their money through the system. Mm-hmm. They know how unfair the game really is. The problem is they can't top it off with a cherry on top. Mm-hmm. And the cherry on top is to look the camera in the eye and say, I made it, but most of my people will never will, because the system is not designed for black people to succeed.
Now, kind of shifting the focus a little bit, we're going to shift from individualism to the I am the only one mindset, and it is connected to individualism. And the I'm the only one mindset is the belief that if something is going to get done right, I have to do it.
All right. Point one is connected to individualism. It is the belief that if something is going to get done right, I have to do it. A lot of y'all gonna feel hit when I swing with this one, but I'm gonna say it anyway. But many of us internalize this one and have a very hard time reaching out for help and also leaning on others when it comes to solving problems, because we are conditioned by a society that is based on this shit to not do it. Work on that if you need to. Point two is little or no ability to delegate work to others. And this is pretty self-explanatory, but again, I will check in with the other videos in this playlist. I think that does a much better job of explaining this. But basically, imagine somebody who feels like they have to solve everything on their own. It's hierarchical and, you know, yeah, it places the power in a small group of people, if not like an individual person's hands. Cough, cough, Supreme Court justices.
Okay, so what are your thoughts on the I am the only one mindset?
I think it stems from a place of, like, we've been talking how you're raised. Because, like, sometimes I'm guilty of doing it because I feel like if I'm not doing it, it's not going to be done right. And I think so it does lead to me taking on more work or taking on stuff that I shouldn't do. But it's like a mindset thing. It is, because if you feel like nobody's going to do your job better than you, but that also signals out, like, the people that's working under you. Sometimes it's okay to delegate, and sometimes it's okay to give somebody else the opportunity to do something. They might shock you at their ability, because somebody had to take a chance on me, so I have to start realizing that. Like, somebody had to say, okay, I'm gonna give her the opportunity to just do this, because mm-hmm. I wasn't always the best at what I'm doing.
Mm-hmm.
So I think that is the biggest thing, that, you know, that especially that point of delegation. I think us as a culture, like, we have a problem delegating because of what our parents did. Like, mama was going to get it done.
Mm-hmm.
Like, mama ain't nobody else going to do it, mama going to get it done. So I think that's where this stems from in our culture. And in the realm of white supremacy, their mindset, I feel like they don't have a problem with the I'm the only one thing, because they always are, like, delegating or letting somebody else do something. Like, you see so many times, like, you know, in a CEO culture when they have, like, daughters and sons, they have their kids in boardrooms when they're like 16,
mm-hmm.
teaching them the ropes, mm-hmm. showing them. So when they do get the opportunity, they know what they're doing. So I think that is more so us, when we feel like, you know, even like with certain, like, even when it comes to beauty standards, it's certain people, like, if it ain't my stylist, I'm not going to go to.
Yeah.
Because she the only one that can do that. But yeah. Sometimes it's okay to take that chance. It's just something minor to show. Like, sometimes it's okay to take that chance. But you might find somebody that you immediately love. Like, even when I first met Morgan, like, I probably didn't talk. I probably was just, like,
chilling.
Not saying much. But after time, and I gave her a chance to, like, you know, show me who she was, and we just started to talk. We saw we had a lot in common. So just learning how to, I think, get out of your own head and get out of that mindset that everything got to be done by you to be right.
Yes. Now, when it comes to this, like, ideology, I think it's good to have an understanding of this type of mindset, but to negate away from it, I would say use discernment. Because you don't want to be put in a situation. I know people use that, like you said, as like a project, like to protect themselves. And it is often a lot of situations where you will try to delegate power to somebody else and they'll leave you high and dry. So that's why I say use discernment. You got to know who to work for, because some people will have you fucked up and they will have you being the only one doing the work, or you're the only one that'll do it correctly. But be mindful in those situations. And I like using school as an example of this, because how many of us have been in group projects and there's at least one or two white people in there and they won't let you do none of the work. They is the group leader. And then on top of that, they gonna take all the work home and do all of it on their own. Now, some people see that as a lift, but there are some people who want to be able to participate, put their own creative or artistic value within it. So just keep in mind that although you're capable of doing something, you are not the only one that has to do it, and someone else might have something to add to it that you might not have access to. So real quick, let's go over the antidotes to this type of mindset. And it's simply just to evaluate people based on their ability to delegate to others, as well as to evaluate people based on their ability to work as a part of a team in order to accomplish shared goals. In what ways does the belief that progress is always bigger and better contribute to the perpetuation of white supremacy culture? So first, Leah, what is the belief that progress is bigger and more?
It's the notion that everything is going to lead to success. It's the notion that everything is going to be the next big thing. It's the notion that one small step for man, giant care for mankind, mm-hmm. is that mindset. Mm-hmm. So slavery. I'm going to abolish slavery. Mm-hmm. Okay, take it as a win, but also then I'm implement Jim Crow laws.
And slave codes.
And then all of that. So progress is not always bigger, and it's not always more. Progress is incremental. It's one step at a time. It's small progress. This leads to somewhere big. Mm-hmm. But it's not always the biggest and the most. It don't contribute to everything, be everything.
Most definitely. And like you said, it truly is that belief that progress is always about being bigger and more. And what it does is it prioritizes the quantity over the quality. And as a result, it really leads to a focus on quick or highly visible results, which may exclude potential allies, as well as a perpetuation of a sense of urgency that hinders through an inclusive decision making. I feel like we see this a lot when it comes to like these huge CEOs with these huge mega companies, or artists. Like, okay, great example would be like the evolution of Cardi B's work, like her whole collection of work. Now, Cardi B probably put out a song like once a year, right? But in order for her to top what she did last year, it has to be what? Bigger and more. So as a result of that, you're seeing like these huge budgets for all the producing of music, these huge big layouts, these tours and stuff. But the quality, like the center of what you're doing, which is coming out with a song, does that make the song good just because you invested so much money, you invested so much time, and you anticipated all these things because you wanted to be bigger and more? Is the quality of it still substantial? Yeah, so those are my thoughts. Like, what are yours?
I also, in the implement of education, I'm talking about education. When the school districts and the state decided to outlaw the requirement to pass state examinations, mm-hmm. to graduate high school, mm-hmm. I think that was, in a lot of people's eyes, it was progress, because they say these kids aren't standardized testers. But in the minds of the world and the United States, compared to the educational system of Mississippi, it was not, the quality was not there, because what those exams did, they made sure students were learning and being able to apply that knowledge.
Yeah.
To applying that knowledge so that they knew they were learning it before they were able to graduate and move on. So I think the outline of that allows students to just do the bare minimum in school and pass. You know, I can speak for my high school. In the high school I went to, you were going to pass. It was very hard for you to fail. So when they outlawed, that was the only thing that kept students who really weren't learning anything. That was the only thing that kept them and made them actually learn. And so I think that what we see now is that the quality of the education there was already compared to other states has always been last in the education. So now that their quality of education, they don't have those tests anymore. They really don't have anything to test to make sure these students are learning what they're supposed to learn while they're going through the school system.
Mm.
Besides the ACT, and then colleges have, since COVID, they've not even been requiring that you can get in school without even taking ACT.
Mm-hmm.
So I think now that it's been the quality, they put that grand scheme of things in and show that, oh, we're making progress to help the students. We're outlining the state tests and standardized testing.
But it's hurting them as a result.
Hurting them. So is that progression? Mm. Yeah, now that my child don't have to take this test and they can't be held back.
Is the quality of the school work,
is it up to the standard? Because Mississippi was already behind the curve. So taking those tests out, what did that do? So I feel like sometimes in the minds of people, what seems like progress, is that really progress, or is that regression that's dressed up real cute in a Halloween costume?
I like that, Leah, and I think that another great example of that can be seen with technology, especially like with the like Gen Alpha, Gen Z, and how like Apple is consistently rolling out these different products. And you know, they're like, oh, like the older generation, they feel dumb because they don't understand the technology, but there's so many things that they physically and have memorized on how to do. And you're obtaining all this technology and all these different resources where you have the potential to gain insight, intellect, education. But as a result of you getting bigger and more, it is resulting in students being less intelligent, having issues with writing, having issues telling time on a regular clock, an analog clock. Like they don't know how to spell words, or their handwriting is shit. Like, it's because they have obtained so much technology, their intellect and their want and need to do shit is like completely shattered.
Artificial intelligence, ChatGPT will be the bane of college. Will be the bane of college students
if they don't learn how to.
They don't learn how to use. If you're gonna use it, use it properly. But if you use it as a crutch in the real world, people are gonna know, like when you get into a job force. If you use ChatGPT to write every single paper, you don't do any research, and you're going into these fields, how are you supposed to perform? The point of college is to teach us to think bigger.
Mm-hmm. It's supposed to teach us how to think in general.
Like, and if you already know how to think, and you feel like you got that, but it's to teach you how to think bigger, how to look at something and not just see it for face value. How to look at even an equation, how to look at an equation and break it down if you're a math major. How to, if you're engineering, how to look at a building and then think about how it was built.
Mm-hmm.
So it's just like, it's the thought process that goes behind things that teach you that. ChatGPT can't teach you that. Chad can't teach you. So I feel like that is becoming a push. And it's in the world, in the eyes of the world, ain't artificial intelligence progress.
Yeah.
But is it really progress? No. Nobody knows what they're doing.
Because AI is still flawed. And
very flawed.
And I think that's very true, because I personally believe that if you're going to use AI, you need to have a sense of knowledge. Like, you have to have an understanding of something so that you can build off of the basic information that ChatGPT, AI, Perplexity is giving to people. So, you know, most definitely.
Yes.
So let's talk about some of the antidotes when it comes to this idea that progress is bigger and more. So the one I found the most interesting was create a seventh generation thinking by asking how the actions of the group will now affect people seven generations from now. So I know you're probably asking yourself, Morgan, what the fuck is the seventh generation thinking? So it stands for, or it represents, indigenous awareness, indigenous relations, and traditional knowledge environment. So the seventh generational principle is based on an ancient philosophy that the decisions we make today should result in a sustainable world seven generations now into the future. And that, again, goes back to like this morality or the thought process of moving with a purpose. Like, you think if Taylor Swift, she fly on the jets everywhere she goes, she here. Do you think she would be consuming as much jet fuel or being on the planes if she was actively thinking about how life would look or the world would look just seven generations from now because of all of the chemicals she's putting in the air because of the jets that she used?
No, I don't think nobody thinks about the seventh generation. We only think about now. Like, I think even I'm guilty of it. Like, we all think about now. Like, when we doing stuff, even like when it comes to drinking, we drink it. We were in college. We were part of freshmen. We drinking every day, every weekend.
Just dog water, anything, driving the boat.
In our body, we not thinking about, dang, I could this give me liver. Like, we not thinking about what's gonna happen when we 47 with all that Casamigos
catch up on
when they catch up with us. But I do think if people did start thinking about that, but I don't think society has ever thought about.
I think
besides the act, like the civil rights era, the civil rights movement, they were the only people thinking about the future.
I want to say is that little. I think that people start thinking about generations after they start having children, like after they birth their next generation. That's when they start thinking about the future, or when they get to the point where they're like prepared enough to start planning to have a second group of people.
And statistically, millennials are having less children than the generation before. So nobody, like every, like we're even. I'm guilty of this. I want to have myself established first before I even think about bringing a kid in the world. Whereas our parents' generation, they were having kids younger, way younger.
And having plenty of, woo, Lord. Like
plenty of kids. So now the kids are
coochie crying for a break.
So we're not having as many kids. So we're not thinking about kids. You know what the saying is when it comes to kids.
What
F them kids. Man. That's what they saying. So we think about seven generations from now. No,
I feel like we also have to look at this like in a realistic light too, yeah. Because we're looking at the state of the world right now. We're seeing how violent people are reacting, and people are not even creating a savings account. They're not saving no money because they don't see no future. So it's a conundrum. Like, it's got your head fucked up because you don't know whether to keep the money in your pocket or give it to the bitch so she can shake her ass in your lap. You don't know what you want to do.
If we ball.
Hey,
that's
how you live once. Like, okay, and you better go live. So, okay, so let's go to the second antidote, and that is to make sure that any cost-benefit analysis includes all the costs and not just the financial ones. And I think that's a great, for example, like the cost of morale or the cost of morality or the cost of credibility or the cost of the use of resources or the cost of your time. And I don't think outside of like physical cash money, people think about that.
I do too.
And that's how you keep yourself in line.
Yes, my time, I don't have time. Like, even though my time is spent on Zina, I don't have that time to give to nobody else but myself. My time is more, cost me more than the physical cash. Time is, you never get time back. You can make money back. You can't make time back. Kevin Gates said it once.
What he said?
You can get anything back except time lost.
Come on now. He said he done threw all his watches away. He ain't got no time for that. Ask him where my heart. Good luck finding it. But I feel most definitely when it comes to the cost of morality, that's where it's got people lost in the sauce. It's got them swallowed. Like people who sell out. Like politicians and stuff. Like you'll sell your whole soul, you'll turn your back on the community, and yeah, you getting thousands and bukus of money, but at what cost? Is it the cost of your morality? Is it the cost of your credibility? Because you ain't going to be able to go back to the hood because them niggas not going to be looking at you the same. Is it the cost of your character? Is it the cost? Like, what are you really losing instead of just gaining money? Because money is not, doesn't make the world spin. Money is not the center of everything. So finally, the last antidote is to include process goals in your planning. So, for example, make sure that your goals speak to how you want to do your work and not just what you want to do. Ask those you work with and for to evaluate your performance. How important do you think goal planning is?
My goals are everything to me. I'm the probably, people, somebody call me goal self-centered. So focused on my goals. Sometimes it to the point where it's toxic, like toxic femininity, toxic masculinity. It's toxic. You can have toxic goals, but goals are important.
What are some of your goals, Leah?
I want to one day serve on the Supreme Court. I want to be a lawyer. I want to get into politics one day. I hope that y'all don't say I sold out. But, you know, I want to get into the political world, and that's a real goal of mine.
Like, mine, too.
I want to be the next. Not the next Kamala Harris.
Nikki Haley.
I want to be the bitch, next Ketanji. Ketanji Brown. I want to be
the next Maxine Waters.
I want to be somebody that my family can say she made history or her story. But I do want to be get into this. The end goal for me is to sit on the Supreme Court. Justice as a Supreme Court justice one day.
So how do you maintain your goals? Like, do you write them out? Do you keep them in the top of your head? You put them in your notes folder in your phone?
They in my phone. They I wrote them out. They in my head. Everything that I do, I move with anything in my professional aspect. I move with the intention of getting to my goals. Nothing is not calculated that I do. My goals are everything to me. Yes, I may get sidetracked, but I'm never getting off the path. Nothing is going to deter me from getting my goals. I done been through hell and back, and it ain't going to stop me from getting my goals. Like, I'm going to get where I'm going. Where it take me 15, 20, 30 years, I'm going to get there. It might not be at the pace that somebody else is, but I'm getting there, and that's another thing. Goals, focus on your goals. Don't look to the side. Be in your lane.
Stay in your Tory lanes, bitch. I'm not Iggy.
Stay in your lane. Focus on your goals, you know, say what you want to do, get in the process of doing it, make a plan for it, and you can get it. Make sure, if you make a goal, just make a plan. Don't let anybody tell you your goal is not attainable.
And you know what? That is the key right there. The goal or the vision that God gave to you was specifically for you. No. And you cannot tell everybody your goals and expect for them to understand it or even be happy for you, because they not their goals. Those are for you.
And it's gonna people that speak, you know, speak that negativity or determine. How many times people have told me, "Oh, you too black. You're too much of a black girl. You wear your hair too long. You wear your nails too long. You get into the world like that."
You'd be shocked what people been told me.
They gonna speak that into your goals.
And yeah, and it's your goal to cast it down like, every time they say it.
It ain't for everybody to support you. Everybody support Jesus.
No. And everybody not able to see it. Like, I'm a visual.
I have the faith to see everything. I didn't see myself. I've been saw myself since I was 12 years old. That's when I decided to switch from being a chef to want to be a lawyer. So I was 12 years old. I just saw myself walking in the courtroom.
That's good. And that's good. I love that for you. I just feel like when it comes to like how people perceive you, especially if you have like an out the box type of personality, character, or you present differently, people will put you in this box and leave you there. And I feel like that is something that has happened to me personally because of the way that I act and or the way that I dress and or my size. So like people expect one thing out of me, but I don't allow those expectations to rule or dictate how I move, how I go about like obtaining my goals and stuff like that. And honestly, like I just have to prove them wrong, and I'm come back every single day swinging because these are my goals and my dreams. Mm-hmm. And ain't nobody gonna get them unless I get up and get them myself.
And that's right, Morgan. And half of that those stereotypes, that box is created from white supremacy. Mm-hmm. Those are the white standards of how somebody should look, or the beauty, you know, the beauty standards, the way you should talk,
the way you should act in public, the way you
should carry yourself, how you should wear your hair, from down to the how you wear your hair, to what you have on your feet, to the clothes you wear on your back. That stems from what?
White supremacy, as well as insecurities in other people.
Because I'm secure. I was been 104 pounds, but couldn't nobody tell me I wasn't the thickest thing in the room.
Good.
I walked in.
Like, what? I be 250. You still can't tell me I ain't the thickest. I ain't. In my mind, I'm like a teacup chihuahua York. Like, I'm real small and cute and fluffy. But that's just me. Like, that's how I carry myself, and that's how I know I do not see myself the way that other people see me. And I'm fine like that. Yes, because I shock myself. Like, every day I get up and I shock myself. I'm learning new stuff constantly. But it's because of the goals that I've set. And, like, you are absolutely right. I believe in taking shit day by day. And I plan on, like, learning new stuff, like, very small stuff. And I feel like, specifically for Black men, I don't think they have goals like that. Like, at all.
And that stems from, I feel like if we poured into... in school, starting the school system, if we promoted students that wasn't male, that wasn't athletes that were shining bright, you know what I'm talking about? Mm-hmm. If we promoted academics like we do athletics.
And rapping and music.
Pay attention. College, national football signing day, how many people tuned in? When it's the national college just for people that's not athletic academics, how many people show up in the gymnasium?
Live.
Promote them academics and them Black boys who want to do art. Black boys who want to dance, Black boys who black that
wanna
black
write, male want to be doctors,
lawyers, promote five, in the five, school system,
trash men,
anything, promote anything besides being an athlete or rapper. If you don't rap or play ball, then you ain't cool. A trap or scam, you ain't. You know,
lame.
You
ain't
the right,
but you could even be a Russell Wilson. You could be a football player, and even if you come off as nice and like your character is still lame and foul.
Yeah, like, oh, you lame because
you're a simp. That's what they say. They like that. They're a simp.
But that's simp for I don't like Black women.
Yes,
because if Russell was doing that to a Brittany Mahomes, Patrick, his wife, where do Patrick Mahomes get that girl to wear him.
Mm.
You don't see people saying he lame.
Mm-mm.
He this, he that.
They wouldn't do that to 21 Savage when he was dating Amber.
They don't do that to Jay-Z. And he how you do Beyonce. Nobody's gonna call Jay-Z lame when he do stuff. Nobody gonna call these men lame that are not dating the women that they feel like. They feel like Ciara's supposed to be with a Russell. I mean, a Future. They feel like Ciara's supposed to be with Future. Somebody with...
That is our perspective, but that differs from how Ciara sees herself. So I completely agree with you. And before we move from this, I just want to say, last night I was sitting at the barbershop and I was just listening and observing some Black men, and for like 30 minutes they was just running their mouth talking about football, right? I don't do no sports. The only thing I exercise is my rights, and I runs my mouth. So I was sitting up there listening, and I heard this 32-year-old man. He was calling out football, basketball statistics. He was talking about the rate of people who was getting signed and drafted. He know who the number one team is. All this information. And I was sitting back and I was just thinking, I was like, you know, it's impressive how much information that he has about sports. But the information that he cares about so much ain't gonna get him no money. Unless he working in that field and he working in that job, it's not going to help nobody. And he just all up in them folks' business. Now, think about what type of position he would be in if he cared that much about politics or the environment or his community or his family.
His business.
Come on. Come on. He know about white women that play basketball all up north. Probably ain't even seen Kim. So, like, I just like, that's what I mean by, like, you got to change your perspective and create goals outside of, like, I feel like men do that because it's normal for men and it's acceptable for them to know about sports and have that stuff. But what is that really bringing to you? Because if anything, it's really just wasting your time and wasting your money.
Betting on it, losing your money.
What?
I'm betting on it. I'm scared to bet, y'all. Don't.
Well, shout out to all the bitches that's hitting licks on parlays. Yes, I love that.
Send it to me.
Girl, send me the rule book. Will you? I think I could use AI and figure some shit out. I really do.
I don't even got time. I'm scared. I like to make money, not lose.
That's real.
So now that we know that there's a full-on attack from white supremacists and goofballs like that on DEI, let's talk about some of the things that they want to see happen. These motherfuckers believe that America is a meritocracy. That's right. They believe that America is a meritocracy and that you get by, you know, hard work and sacrifice. If that is the case, if that is truly the case, then some of you average white men will be screaming your lungs out for diversity, equity, and inclusion. You will. You will be begging us on hands and knees like boys to men for diversity, equity, and inclusion. And do you know why? I'll tell you. You see, America has never been a meritocracy. Never. Never. Understand me, never. It has always been a good old boys club. And your dumbasses are the workers, and the good old boys are the legacy admission guys. Yeah. They reinforce their ability to get through life because daddy owned something and granddaddy owned even something more. They have augmented that shit with you dumbasses. Yeah. They're the ones that tell you over and over that someone got something over on you based on something that you don't have. It's true. It was those idiots that convinced you that affirmative action was giving black people unfair advantages at the workplace and in school. Not realizing that your biggest enemy wasn't some black person that got into school and their grades weren't as good as yours, but it was a legacy admission guy who got in and his grades were ass and they were 10 times worse than yours, but he still got in anyway. Ain't that something? Your biggest enemy was legacy admissions, but the powers that be convinced you it was affirmative action. Mm-hmm. Just like they're right now trying to convince you that DEI is a dangerous thing. Diversity, equity, and inclusion. Now, why would they be doing that? Well, it's probably because they realize that their ideas are shit. They genuinely are. And they're brought to you in part by these lazy legacy admission fucking silver spoon type motherfuckers who are using the augmented strength of poor white men to get where they want to go in life. It's true. You are fighting against your own fucking best interest because you think that if we turn America into a meritocracy, that somehow your life is going to be better. It has never happened and it never will happen. As long as people are connected, you will never get anywhere. Don't believe me? You swear up and down that you're experiencing racism at the hands of black people. No, the biggest racism that you will ever face in your life is by people who look just like you. They just happen to live in a very, very, very higher much tax bracket than yours. You don't think they call you names? You don't? Not only do they call you names, they use you. Mm-hmm. While you're down here tussling with black and brown people, the rich white folks, yeah, they don't like you either. And the difference between them and us is that we have no power over controlling your life, whereas they do. Think about that. You work at a place. You've been working there for 20 years. You think you're doing well. You think you're going to be a supervisor and things of that nature. Well, guess what? The owner of the company, before he dies, he signs everything over to his ne'er-do-well ass fucking son. And his son decides to pull a Bain Capital and liquidate the fucking place and take your job. Now, he'll get a golden parachute, you'll just get a golden shower. Yes. See, you would be begging, absolutely 100% begging to have DEI if this was truly a meritocracy. Because guess what? The powers that be, the people who have their hands on the levers, they have children. And they're going to look after those children long before they look after your dumb ass. Why the fuck do you think they keep pushing the Second Amendment on you? Because that's all they've given you. That's it. They tell you you have to work hard for everything else. Even though the same people that tell you, work hard, slugger, and you'll get someplace. Their kids aren't working. Their kids aren't working at all. They're just waiting for dad to keel the fuck over and they'll inherit all of that. And they get to give you the same fucking speech talking about how hard they worked. Nepotism and legacy is what's really fucking you up. Not black people. Not affirmative action, not DEI. So if these guys finally said, hey, we have a meritocracy, you're fucked. Because there will be nobody there to argue for you. You've alienated us. You thought we were just getting shit because we were brown or we were gay or we were Native American or we came over the border illegally. When in actuality, the person that has the purse strings in your life is getting their money from a motherfucker that has all the money. And if he just decides to liquidate the fucking company so that he can go sail off to Belize in a yacht with another yacht in it, there's absolutely nothing you could do about it. He'll still keep telling you, work hard, you'll be where I'm at. It will never happen. It will never happen. See, they give you guys the meritocracy bootstrap story on purpose. Trump's kids have never had to work hard. Bezos's kids will never have to work hard. Elon Musk's kids will never have to work hard. Mark Zuckerberg's kids will never have to work hard, ever. And those kids will one day run something that affects you. And they're going to take it out right the fuck out from underneath you. And you'll get mad. You'll get mad at the black and the brown, not realizing that we're standing right next to you. We're getting the same treatment. You will continue to fight amongst the people down here because we're just not working hard, even though you're working twice as hard as these motherfuckers, and you just can't seem to get ahead. Now, can you? That's what you have to look forward to in a meritocracy here in America, since it's never happened before. I mean, for fuck's sake, this place was started by a bunch of rich sons who couldn't wait for their inheritance. They just wanted to have it right now. And it has been that way ever since. That's why it's rugged individualism for poor people and socialism for rich folks. So if getting rid of people like Claudine Gay at Harvard and getting rid of DEI, if that's your goal and that's what you really want to have happen, then congratulations. That's exactly what you're working towards. But please understand, it's not going to work well for you. You're never going to get in those enclaves. You're never going to get into those country clubs. Those people talk bad about you to your fucking face, and you still support them. But you swear up and down that the racism that you're feeling is coming from people who are in the same socioeconomic bracket as you. No. We're telling you the history. And part of that history is guys like that have been fucking guys like you since Bacon's Rebellion. There's no meritocracy in this country, and it never will be. Not as long as we have an elite. And no, gentlemen, the elite aren't Jewish people. The elite are rich oil barons, rich team owners, rich factory owners, the fucking family that owns Walmart, the DuPont family, families like that. And you will never be one of them. They have set up the system to where you will fight your ass off to keep them where they are at the expense of the rest of us down here. You are their attack dogs, or as they like to call you, attack crackers. Congratulations. You are now sitting here wiping out the board against of any ally or accomplice you will ever have in this to sniff the throne of these motherfuckers. And they still will not accept you. But they'll keep telling you, we need a meritocracy. Let me explain to you what a meritocracy is going to mean for you. That means as hard as your father worked and never got anywhere. As hard as your grandfather worked and never got anywhere. As hard as your great-grandfather worked and never got anywhere. You're going to work three times as hard as they are. You're still not going to get anywhere. And you're going to lose your rights as they go along. But you'll keep supporting these jackasses because they'll keep telling you, work a little harder. You can get up here with us.
What strategies can be employed to address these persuasive traits within educational spaces and organizational dynamics?
The step number one, wrote a discussion about it's called representative bureaucracy. Representative bureaucracy.
Okay.
So that's putting minorities, whether they be women, people of color,
in positions of power,
places so that we can feel comfortable. I had one black teacher my freshman year. She was my American government teacher. I didn't want to go to any class but that class because there was a sense of comfort for me. How many of my students say, I'm glad to see you. And I'm just a freshman. Just work with one little class freshman. Just, you know, but it makes them feel seen. It makes them feel heard. It makes them feel like she did it. She graduated.
If she can do it, I can do it.
You know, my sisters, they got their degrees going back to school. That for me, come from a small town, it ain't a lot of that. But that for me, when they went and did it, they finished college.
they did it, I can do it. You know, I may not agree with Kamala Harris' politics at times. We don't, you know, but she did it.
I can do it.
Putting us in these places and
having proper representation.
Representation matters, from the baby dolls to the television shows to the courtrooms, and not the ones in the chains, the ones sitting up there in the black and white.
I like the idea of Sexy Red, Sukiana, all the ghetto girls when it comes to these conversations, because like I always say, when it comes to urban women, like real ghetto hood bitches, they deserve that type of representation. And I feel like people have a negative stigma attached to them just because they don't act in the way that proper society would like them to. They're uniquely and truly themselves because of the environment they went to. And those women deserve to have people that look like them, act like them, talk like them, dress like them on TV. And if them girls can see a Sexy Red, a Sukiana, all these bitches make it, that gives them the courage to say, if they can make it, I can make it too.
And I feel like everybody has their niche. That's not my niche.
That's not my niche either.
You know, but that's okay. But I also feel this is it. We need to, as black people, we need to stop letting reality TV shows get on there and paint us out to be like that.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? So I remember a time when Love and Hip Hop, Real Housewives of Atlanta, all of that, women with knowledge, education, married to medicine, women with education, knowledge, resources. Why are y'all getting on TV and letting them paint y'all out to be something that you're not?
Well, you see what that money make a bitch nigga do.
That's what I'm saying. So we need to stop that, because now when I go into these spaces, people looking at me, you know, the debacle with Dr. Jack and what she said. Now people like, now people questioning every decision that you done made, everything you done, because you got on social media and you said something that wasn't reflective of who you claim to be.
Or the people you represent.
So now I have to be cautious of how I present myself on social media. And not because I'm worried about what somebody else is going to say. Not because I worry about somebody thinking. Because I know what I want to do. And I don't want nobody at no job saying, oh, well, I'm February 2nd on social media. You said this, that. You hate black people, but now you want to run for office. Mm. Or I think black people cry wolf too much. But now I want to represent them. Mm. That's not indicative of what I want to do.
Mm-hmm.
So I tell people, the freedom of speech is free. But sometimes
it'll cost you.
It will cost you more than you. Like, we were just talking about cost. Like, analyze that cost of what you're going to say before you say it. My mom always told me I used to have a mouth. Think before you speak.
Well, my mom used to say, your mouth will write a check, your ass can't cash.
And it might not write it right now. It might not be trying to. It might not bounce right now. It might not bounce tomorrow. It might be 10 years down the road, like they did with Kevin Hart for the Grammys by the tweet he made.
Mm-hmm.
So that's what I'm saying. We have to be cautious with what we say, because people are using anything, ready to use it to villainize and weaponize it and make us, you know, in educational spaces, stop letting people tell you, as black women and black men, what we have to be, what we should be. We should go do whatever major you want to do,
mm-hmm.
go to whatever career choice you want to do. I don't care if it's one, it's never been that to happen. Stop letting people tell us.
Let it dictate what you do.
So, because everybody not meant to go to the medical field. Everybody not meant to be a lawyer. Everybody not meant to be an engineer. You find what's for you, because it might not be what everybody that look like you are doing. Okay, go be an ag business major.
Mm.
You go do you some wildlife and fisheries. You go do whatever that's not. You do whatever you want to do that is to your heart content, and you stick to that. Regardless, if you don't see nobody that look like you in there, it might be hard. It is going to be hard. It's hard to get an education, especially pursuing higher education in these predominantly white spaces. But we made a decision to stay. I made a decision to go to school here. I made a decision to stay in school here for grad school, so I got to deal with it.
Mm-hmm.
Got to deal with it.
Mm-hmm.
But I will deal with it in the right way. If I feel unseen and unheard, I will voice it to my professors. I'm never scared to voice my opinion.
Mm-hmm.
I will start voicing when you feel uncomfortable in these spaces. That's what you do.
Yes.
You speak out.
Say something. Don't let it slide.
Like, don't, yeah, just stop.
Write it up, too. Put it on some paper.
Send in the email.
Okay.
BCC, click on there. If y'all don't know, blind copy.
Come on. You're putting on. Come on.
And so realize that. Find yourself a niche of people who going to support you no matter what in these educational spaces. It's so important. And outside of Greek life, find you some people.
Outside of football and basketball.
Find you some people who align with your educational interests if you're really interested in dismantling this white supremacy era of these educational spaces. Even at HBCUs, it's still white supremacy and HBCU
because culture. Of respectability politics. Like,
so stop letting people tell you also, because you went to an HBCU, your degree is not any less weird despite what society wants you to believe. Because let me tell you, my sisters, all three of them went to HBCUs. Can't tell me nothing about them. The best nurse I know went to Mississippi College from Alcorn, had a 4.0 in getting her master's. The other one is in a PhD program, making all A's. So that's not vindictive to say, oh, you went to HBC, you're not just that. So stop letting society define what you define as appropriate educational spaces. Find your space, mm-hmm. find your needs, find your people, and just live with it.
I love that. Now, I'm a believer that you can skin a cat more than one ways. So the way that you will go about combating white supremacy, especially in school culture, although it works for you, I do the inverse of it. And it ain't nothing wrong with that. Yeah. So, like, I think it's so interesting because, like me, I push the bounds, especially, like, with my podcast or, like, how I operate. Like, I move through the world and I'm pushing the boundaries because if you allow me to speak the way that I speak, because I don't code switch often. I speak in my regular country AAVE accent, right? I'm going to do that in front of them professors. I'm going to do that when I go to church. Why? Because it needs to be normalized, because a black person should be able to come up in here and speak the way that they should, be able to put it in layman terms as well as put it into academic terms, and it should still be acceptable to other people. So, like, I'm the type of person, like, I'm trying to normalize stuff for people, because it's so many people that are catch flack for, like, being, like, truly black, being truly themselves. And if we get to a point now where, like, okay, this person, she doing X, Y, and Z, and she can do all this, and she told gun, because I told a gun, you get me? I smoke weed. I dress the way that I want to dress. If I can make it normal, if more people can start to accept it, then it opens the door for all the people behind me that people told that they would never make it, that they'll never be nobody, and they'll never go nowhere because of how they dress, how they talk, and how they look. They counted them out. And I'm definitely a part of that crowd that got counted out for real. So, like, that's why I do stuff the way that I do, and I push the boundaries and I make people feel uncomfortable, because what that's going to do is going to cause somebody to think. It's going to make them wonder and ponder in their head, okay, if she can do that, then I feel free enough to be able to express myself. I can navigate the world as my true authentic self, and I don't have to code switch or do all this other shit while I'm navigating life. You know, it just gives people, like, that feeling, I can just be myself. So just like you have a tactic to be able to do it, I have one, and ain't not one is better than the other one. And I think people need to get to an understanding of that.
Yeah, it's not like somebody asked me, do it, did I close switch? No, my voice is my voice. Everybody knows my voice, but I am a professional version of me. Like, I ain't in the office talk about some, you know, being it, make it, you know, yeah. I'm not singing Sexy Red in the office.
I ain't doing that either.
You know, but I'm saying, so I am a professional version of me. And if you meet me as Renalicia, that's probably what you're going to get, the version that's professional, because I'm in these spaces. I'm like, okay, you know, I'm at work. That's how I put it. I'm at work. When I'm at home. When I'm off that clock, the moment, that whatever the time I get out of work, when the moment it hit, I'm off the clock. I have no accountability to that job. So that's my thing with people. I tell people this all the time. Coming from a small town with a little country accent, mm-hmm. I walk into work some days. One day I got my fro out. Next day I got on a wig. The next day I might have on another wig.
Mm-hmm.
You don't think I get the looks?
Mm-hmm.
I get that. Yes, I wear my long nails to work. Yes, I will keep my piercing nails when I go to work. Yes, I wear hoop earrings to work. Yes, mm-hmm. I wear my lashes.
And the lip gloss too.
Yes, I reapply my lip gloss in the middle of the meeting because my lips might look a little dry.
Bitch, I'm pulling out an LED mirror.
But I do tell people this. When I got hired, when I got my graduate assistantship, they knew who I was.
Yeah.
When I got hired as a student worker, they knew who I was.
Yeah.
They accepted me because I was me.
And your work speaks for itself.
I'm a very intelligent person.
You will know a tree by its fruit.
Like, I'm not out here trying to be, I think if I had to be like a fruit, I'm a banana. Mm.
You
know,
you got to pull it back. Yeah.
I'm not trying. I ain't trying to be no apple. I'm too hard, too crunchy. I don't want to be an orange either. Mm-mm. So it's, I know who I am.
Baby food, easily digestible.
Right. So it's just, that's what I am. So everywhere I go, I'm a banana. Maybe I shouldn't represent this place to a monkey, but I'm a banana. Like, you know, that's just what I am. But for real, like, it's just about being who you are, but also realizing it, you know, because I've saw people, you know, you can't go in these job, these people place of business, talk about some, what up, my bro? Like, that is not your brother. He don't even look like you. That is not your brother. I don't have, like, I at work, I'm professional. I don't have friends. Like, at the job, like, we not friends. Like,
we colleagues.
Like, we, you know, we might peers. Kiki, you know, we get a little lunch kiki, but we ain't finna be in my business telling you what I was doing. You know, it's not that. So I think that's what we should do to keep that dynamic that we can be unprofessional. Because I think that's where that dynamic that we're unprofessional in these workspaces come from.
I do believe that there is a time and place.
Yes.
And if anybody watched last episode of Baddies, they definitely, even for the baddest black bitches out here, they still operate by the ideology that there is a time and a place to yes.
Freedom of speech doctrine. The freedom of speech, it ain't free. It's time, place, and manner. Like, you go to a fire, you go to a movie theater and scream fire, and ain't no fire, somebody died. You're not free to speak like that. It's a time and place to do. You just a time, place, and manner to do every single thing. Our time and place to drink and turn up is at the bar.
Uh-huh.
We ain't talk about popping bottles at the office.
And not at the altar either, baby.
And don't worry, but you know what I'm saying? Like, if you want to do something at church, you shouldn't do it at work. That's my rule of thumb. If I can't do it at church, I only be doing it at work.
I just feel like you should not do the most, but yeah. Be yourself.
Yes.
And you can do it at different ranges or levels, but at the core, continue to be yourself. Because, yeah, I'm going to do this. I'm going to cuss, and I'm going to throw up my middle finger, and I throw up gang signs and stuff. But when it's time for me to get on stage and speak in front of a group of people, or they ask me to come teach a lecture, or they ask me to record a national video for my organization, well, we gonna dally it up a little bit.
You know,
we gonna put lipstick on a pig. Yeah. It's still a pig, but she look pretty now.
Cute. Little Charlotte.
Now, a few more strategies before we close out. Naming and confronting white supremacy culture and its manifestations. Call it out when you see it. Girl, so yesterday, well, not yesterday, this week, I work for AmeriCorps Vista. So I had to go to Oxford to do a national campaign. Oxford has like the greatest chapter of AmeriCorps Vista in America, which is an honor. So they wanted to record us in Mississippi. And when I went up in there, you know, when I talk, I make people laugh. I don't consider myself to be a class clown. I'm just a funny individual because I'm a light. So this man, he gonna tell me, okay, since we taking pictures, I want you to make everybody laugh when it's time to take pictures. You know, I didn't like that because that was giving minstrelsy. But I didn't say nothing because I was at my workplace and I was like, this is not the time or the place for me to call that man out. So then we took individual pictures and did our individual videos. And he gonna say, can you be more sassy like you were when you first came in? Give us a little bit more sass. And I told that man, I said, I'll think about it. Because I felt like he was playing me. He using all these negative characteristics to characterize me. I was about to tell him, have you never heard not to call a black woman sassy? Like, that's a trigger word for a lot of black women because you putting us in that box. But then it also relates to like the right to comfort too. So I took his comfortability away. He was all up in my face telling me all that shit. And I said, you look awfully tan today. And then white man, he said, I just came back from the Bahamas. I was like, I bet your ass did. But like, what if I was in the space to do so, because I have to stop myself, I would have called it out.
That's the battle, because it's so hard to not, I struggle with it, it's so hard to just not say certain stuff, not call it out. But I realized this, when you start calling out everything, you start doing that, it just puts a target on your back, a bigger one, because you already got one on your back.
Mm-hmm.
But I do feel like this, I do stuff like that, okay, I would have took it, went and told my supervisor, you know, just you know, let's just have a talk. You know, this I didn't feel comfortable and let them handle it, because I feel like at that point, the next time you go, he's going to keep doing the same thing. So I feel like that is a thing. So like it's just finding a way to like restrain ourselves, because sometimes as a black woman, I do want to pop off and get a little.
It ain't no, I will pop off because it come out real quick. Like, but I'm learning. Like, I'm trying to learn how to reel it in and, like,
keep toning it down.
Well, I'm working on being nice nasty. See, like, I'm usually just nasty. But I'm trying to make it a little subtler and have a little more flair to it.
Yeah, you giving me sass too.
Yeah, me and you sitting up here looking like butterscotch together. You looking awfully brown today, sir. Happy Black History Month. So the next strategy is going to be promoting anti-racism. And we're going to do this by integrating racial equity work into the core of educational practices. Again, I don't know how realistic that can be, especially since they are gunning to get rid of DEI. What is it? Diversity, equity, and inclusion. So it'll, you know, try to promote anti-racism, maybe not in educational spaces, but like your day-to-day talking, specifically for white people. Like, you know how white people get into spaces and they get to calling each other and saying little racial stuff because they have a secret code of conduct that, like, when nobody's around, that they can do what they want to do and stuff, and then it'll make other white people feel uncomfortable. Call it out. Confront it and then promote anti-racism. And I know that's got to be nerve-wracking because, you know, white bitches got them emotional support dogs. They be stressed the hell out. But I need you to say something and go home and cuddle what they call their dogs, Bubba. You got to go home and rub him at night. Okay, Dexter. Next, build community and unify students across cultural differences. If you are in a university, there should be some type of community that you should be able to join. There's always going to be a BSA, an NAACP, a Black Student Union, one of those. But even outside of universities, I want to encourage everybody to join some type of club, some type of hobby outside of like the internet and online gaming. Just join a community and build your community and unify yourself. And sit on the fifth, make sure to dismantle bias within discipline systems. You, again, call shit out, cast it down when you feel like something is wrong. And lastly, make sure that you are engaging in honest conversations about race and providing relevant teaching resources. And I know you in academia, I be seeing videos online where white people be like, I be pretending to be so liberal when I'm in school doing my coursework, and I turn it in and they full-fledged Trump supporter. So, like, yeah, let's be honest.
Yeah, it's definitely some of that. Like, even just sitting in the classroom, you know, like, but honestly, here, it don't be too much. It be honest. They be detailed. They gonna say, they gonna walk in the class with the hat on.
Yeah.
MAGA.
Yeah.
But,
or one of them black flags. The blacked out American flag, or one of the blacked out American flag with a blue stripe down the middle. Oh boy, it's giving my country tears a deep, boy.
And engaging in a conversation, even with amongst your own race, like being honest with each other,
like we doing right now.
Like, like calling out, like everybody not gonna agree on everything. Like,
no,
we're not anti-black because we don't agree with something. I'm not anti-black because I don't really, you know, I don't personally want to listen to sex degree. I'm not anti-black. I'm happy that she's shining in her own light, but it's just not my cup of tea, and that's fine.
Yeah, but as long as you're giving credit, yeah, what credit, yes, is
you,
due.
You're not going to be everybody's cup of tea. I personally don't like sweet tea. They might be unsweet or little.
Oh, diabetic or something. They can't have all that sugar.
So, you know, it's about just, you know, being honest and being open and being able to, like, navigate and talk to each other within these spaces.
Something that's been very helpful and enlightening was going through the 15 characteristics of white supremacy culture by Tima Okun and unlearning those characteristics. You would think from something called characteristics of white supremacy culture that it would include a lot of obviously bad behavior that nobody would engage in unless they had malicious intent, and that's really not the case. I was pretty surprised the first time I looked at the 15 characteristics because some things were obvious, like power hoarding and paternalism, but other things I thought were just natural to human nature, like the right to comfort and avoiding open conflict. Then there were the things that I had been taught to aspire to as positive traits like perfectionism, objectivity, and individualism. And that helped me realize that a reason why white supremacy culture is so insidious is because many of us would not deliberately choose to uphold white supremacy, but we've been trained to engage in behaviors and to uphold attitudes that support white supremacy, and we don't even recognize it. So what I did was I took a characteristic each week to focus on, and I would take the week to journal about what I think that characteristic means, how I subscribe to it, how long I've been subscribing to it, and when that characteristic was implicated in a situation that came up during the week, I would write about that, and then I would brainstorm alternate ways to think about or approach that situation. My partner did this with me, my coworkers did this with me, and that was really helpful because it's not a process that begins and ends. It is something that is ongoing. So there's nothing wrong with this comment. This question is great, but I'm going to use it as an example for how the pillars of white supremacy culture can arise even when we are trying to do something positive. So one of the characteristics is worship of the written word. We are taught that when we want to learn about something, we want to be objective, factual, accurate. We want to make sure there's validity. So we ask for articles and books. And that's erased cultures that had oral traditions. And it can also lead us to gaslight when people are talking about their lived experience, because if it's not something that's backed up in a book, then we don't think it's true. Also, people who have been marginalized have also been marginalized from the opportunities to publish. So there is less written material by and for the very people that we are seeking to learn from. And to that end, the most helpful and enlightening thing for me is listening to Black and Indigenous people, because they are the ones who have been harmed the most and the longest by white supremacy culture. So they're the ones with the most familiarity, the most information, and they have the solutions, but we have to listen.
Shout out to the slaves.
Yeah, shout out to the slaves. You feel me? Shout out to Harriet Tubman. That
shout out
to
them. She's bitch. A real nigga.
Shout out to them Mississippi niggas. Yeah, yeah. Shout out to them Mississippi niggas. Yeah, big penitentiary tractor dragon ass niggas. Niggas. Yeah. And they don't talk loud. They whisper. Dangerous niggas whisper.
And shout out again to all those people who hate my guts.
Y'all are doing a justice and an effort to the world. Keep breaking these men down one at a time.
Shout out LGBTQ.
You are obsessed and sick.
And we are back with the big black shout out, the blackest shout out in the world. Now, the big black shout out is an opportunity to help circulate the black dollar back into our communities, as well as for our audience members to explore black owned hidden gems. So, Leah, who would you like to shout out today?
Okay, just a few of my, some of these are my friends and other people I swear by if you ever met me in person. So my makeup artist, she's located in Starkville. Her Instagram is Afrocentric. She's the best in the world. Like, love her. She's the best in the world. So if you're in Starkville or the GTA area, look with her.
In Mississippi now.
Yeah.
That's in Mississippi.
So my last chick located in Starkville, Mississippi is Meek by Naya on Instagram. She does wonderful. The retention is 10 out of 10. It takes me at least 4 weeks to dig a field. So
that's nice.
Yeah, so, and the price point is very reasonable.
What's the price point?
The price point is, I think they start at 85, and they,
yeah, that's the basis set.
You can get one for, I think, 100.
So you can fly away.
You can find your niche with the price point.
That's powerful.
Yes. Okay. And the next one is also my nail tech located in South Mississippi. And if you go to the nail shop, she is way cheaper. Morgan can testify, my nails are long.
They are gorgeous.
And they got designs on them, and the set was $75. So, the nail shop, this would cost me a good
$150.
So, she's located in South Mississippi. Her Instagram is J McKenzie Nails. Sweet. She has a booking site. She don't have a million rules on her booking site. So, y'all know,
just clean up under your nails and wash your hands real good. Put some Vaseline on too. Y'all niggas struggling this winter.
Yep. EOS.
Perfect. Ash.
Boy.
But remember that only you can prevent wildfires.
Yes. And then the fourth one is a brand called Exotic Issues on Instagram. This is somebody I went to high school with. His name is Tay. He has a recent hoodie collection. I just got the blue hoodie. I will be posting on Instagram any soon, but definitely shop his hoodies. They're affordable. They're not like, you know, $80 hoodies. They're affordable, probably for like $40 for the hoodie, which is not bad. It's good quality, very nice. And then the last one is also from my hometown. Her name is Danae Lachey Co. on Instagram. She sells HD lace wigs, pre-made 5x5 units.
Hold on, is they raw hair or human hair?
It's both. You can get both. You have options for your price point. So if you just want to spend, you know, have a good quality virgin hair,
yeah,
you know,
it might be a little stiff. Now that raw gonna get you right. Yes, that's right. How we like to take it anywhere.
So those are my big black shout outs. If y'all want to shop, y'all definitely should. All of these are black young business owners. If y'all want to support them.
Yes, well, shout out to all the hot young Ebonies out here making their motherfucking money. Now, if you or someone that you know owns a business, needs a shout out, or would like free promotion, make sure you are reaching out to me at AfrocentricPodcast@gmail.com. That's AfrocentricPodcast@gmail.com. Wow. This has by far been one of my favorite episodes that I have recorded. Episode part 3, The Subtle Art of Dismantling White Supremacy. Leah, I want to thank you so much for your wisdom, your insight, and your words when it comes to dismantling white supremacy within educational spaces. Now, before I let you go, is there anything that you would like to say to the black community?
Yes, you are seen, you're heard, you're loved, you matter, and just keep living it day by day. I know it may be hard out there sometimes being a person of color, but just keep living. Our ancestors will do so much, and they kept living, they kept striving. So, you know, I know it's hard, but just keep living, keep being yourself, keep striving at your goals, and we all gonna win one day. We will win.
That was so powerful and so precise. Thank you again. All right. So I want to thank you guys. Thank you so much to my listeners. Thank you so much for choosing to be Afrocentric today. Please remember that Black Lives Matter. Make sure that we are listening and protecting Black women and children. And remember that the only thing you must do in this lifetime is be Black and die. Now, here at the Afrocentric Podcast, we're just civilized people having civilized conversations. We'll talk to you guys soon. Bye-bye.
Granddad, you can't tame the white supremacist power structure with cheese.
Oh, yes, I can.
No, you can't.
Yes, I can.
No, you cannot.